Would it work to straighten that beat out for when that vocal part comes in? It doesn't groove at all.
Well, if we play a kick right before it.
Maybe. It just, it doesn't, there's something that doesn't, like it feels like the whole thing.
We could add more kicks to match the vocals too. You know, or like play with a groove to match the vocals. But I really like it not being in four. I really like the vibe of it. Like, I feel like it sounds right for some reason.
I think with a couple of extra picks, it could be meant to groove on it.
Yeah, because we left that really open. And I think that instrumentally, that's the correct beat. You know? But
we are really using a lot of the lessons that we've learned over the years about communication, how best to manage our writing chemistry and process. And all of those sort of minute things that tend to make all the difference. And I think it's because we figured out a way to streamline our writing process.
You sounded weird about the end there.
Yeah, I was just thinking about that one bit.
But you played it right. That was fucking sweet. That was beautiful.
Yeah, for Juggernaut, we wanted to try and take that whole approach and go into a professional studio space, but this time be our own masters. And coming into this album, we knew we had less time. And we wanted to try kind of stripping back, almost back to where we were in Periphery 1, where we did things in an apartment, and just be in like a real comfort zone where we could record and write simultaneously and just feel really creative the whole time.
Hey.
What's up?
What's up, you Just kidding. What's going on?
Hey.
How are you? Hey, what's up, Jeff?
Hey, what's up?
What's going on?
How's it, man?
How you doing? I didn't mean to call you.
Hey.
What are you guys doing?
Just working out some bullshit, you know? Okay. You want a chair?
Sure. Grab your own, bitch. Okay. Now, Ed, you want that red one?
Sure.
It's a little wonky on that run. Yeah. I could just do the... It's kind of hard to hear the character when it... Could you just mute the other side? I wasn't happy with that, I don't think. I guess that was fun, right?
Yeah. I think, like, for me, I'm kind of listening to the symmetry of it, which is why it helps to have the other one, but we don't have to if you don't want to.
Jakey?
Yes?
Is it? The first time around, you do. On the third time, or is it...
It has that extra note.
It has that note? Yeah. So the second time, I was wondering if we should...
Whatever sounds better, right?
I think the best part of working on the album at Misha's house is that it has the comfort of home. It's Misha's place, so it's... He lives here as well as works here, and we're all invited to stay with him, and we're already a pretty close band, so it's just kind of like hanging out with your friends, and there's no pressure. Like, I'm in sweatpants right now. barely get dressed every morning. I just work in my pajamas, as most of us do.
I think it does allow for some kind of creativity to come out if you're doing it in a retreat style or in a retreat format. Knowing that you have nowhere to go at the end of the day and knowing that you're near the product, you're near the process 24 hours a day and for days and weeks, that it's what you live and it's what you breathe. You go to bed thinking about what you worked on, you wake up thinking about what you worked on.
Thank you.
It was just a little late.
You want to do it again?
Let's try it again.
So guitars, bass, and even the synths, the analog synths, are going through the DI here. So they're being captured. We got a radial J48 for that. That's going out to the AXE-FX. For our interface, we're using a Focusrite Claret Thunderbolt interface, which is great because it's got way less latency than a USB interface, and it's got all the ins and outs that we need. And I use this Nave Instruments controller just as my MIDI controller for everything. We've got Superior Drummer is what we're using to program, to write, but Matt is going to the studio to track the drums very soon. We're actually doing that at the end this time around. Another thing that I have to say we've been doing a little different this time is we have two analog synths that we've been using for layering or just doubling guitar lines sometimes. It sounds really good. The Moog Sub 37 over here and the Korg Mini Log, which just came out. I wanted a regular log, but all I could afford was a mini log. One thing I really like doing is the Sub 37 just seems to double up on guitar lines really, really well. In a way where you don't necessarily even know that it's there, but when you take it out, it's like, oh, there's a lot of body missing from the guitar. So it's kind of a subtle way to reinforce stuff. Other than that, let's see, you've been using Nolly's various, basically you have the Benetton ad of basses over here. These serve us quite well. We just plug into the AXE-FX, and we're also taking DIs of those as well in case we need to reamp or do stuff in the box with the DIs. Then we also have an extensive pedal collection. You'll see they're sort of littered everywhere because we're just kind of using them as we need them. There's a bunch there, a bunch on the ground, a bunch over there as well. And our general rule is anything that we put in front of the amp will just go in front of the AXE-FX. It takes pedals very well. So it gets kind of a unique sound to the effects that would be on the AXE-FX already. Even though there are a lot of the same types of effects, a lot of these have very specific flavors. And I know them at this point, so if I have something in mind, I'll usually have a pedal in mind for that. So that's pretty useful. And then the rest are just options, you know? We're still not done spice racking, as we call it, so, you know, as we write, as we get everything together, we start to look at what can we add to make these parts better or to give some depth to these songs. So yeah, as far as the guitars and bass and composition goes, this is the gear that we're using. We'll be using this setup to mix. As far as drums, that's being done in England at Middle Farm. So Nolly and Matt are flying out for that, and they're going to have a whole smorgasbord of gear to work with there and a nice drum room. And Spencer's doing his vocals in his studio setup, and I know that he's got a pretty crazy vocal chain going on for that. Feels better. Let's see how that sounds.
So in Periphery 3 we have pretty much any choice in guitar you could think of. It's pretty overwhelming sometimes, and figuring out what the best instrument is for each individual part is kind of part of the writing process and the recording process. Common thing that you find between me, Mark's, and Misha's guitar is there's a certain type of action that we go for. It's very low action on the strings. It has a very bright and spanky tonality to it. Mm-hmm. how you pick is such an important part, you know. It's just how you hold the pick, how the pick hits the strings, your finger tone, how your fingers rest on the fretboard, and how close they are to the frets.
Two cleans and two.
Well, I just replaced two dirty ones.
No, the top ones were definitely dirty. Clean.
Are you sure?
Pretty positive.
I think the philosophy always just has to be what is going to sound good. And to me, what sounds good is generally not something that sounds very robotic and edited. So you're kind of chasing this slightly different perfection, which is things to sound really tight and in tune and together, but also sound like they were played by a human. We're always trying to find that fine balance of being able to have clarity and have the riffs be completely audible and sound perfect, but never for it to sound like a computer was doing the playing.
Fuck!
easy to want to write the same things over and over again because you already know what the outcome is going to be. For me, I don't like that. I want to hear different things and hopefully expand what periphery means instead of just retread it.
It's gonna be a challenge figuring out where to plug in because everything is in that room. This is a remodel in the basement. Mm. So
yeah, we just need one power. Just one plug.
Is there a ride that already looks like this?
Yeah. Oh. Kind of. It's got a different bell.
It looks really sweet.
These just got here. I think calling it P3 is definitely a return form. And this album definitely is sort of the evolution of P1 and P2. P1 was really technical. We kind of didn't know what to do with the vocals. P2 was a little bit more vocal friendly, but also really technical. And I think this album sort of has that nice balance between writing parts that are conducive to the vocals, but also having parts that are extremely technical and interesting instrumentally. Let's do, what's hashtag? Tempo. Do you know? Off the top of your head.
Didn't I send it to you yesterday?
I don't know if you sent me everything. Let me look.
It's in the file name, isn't it?
Oh yeah, 143. You got it. Yeah,
143. Doing doubles?
Yeah, I mean, I've been playing a lot of these songs with just my left foot.
Really?
So, I mean, like... Those are the kinds of things I'm doing to get it up, but yeah. It's just not responding past a certain point.
Yeah, no, of course.
So
I'm just saying, your right foot doubles are so strong that, like, you know, if you got your left foot up to there, I wouldn't be surprised if you could get that speed off doubles.
Yeah, I don't know. I'd have to try it. Doubles are weird to me.
Yeah, they are weird. Even Rudy was trying for the longest time, and he just couldn't get it.
This is weird. Well, let's try this fucking song.
Shift splitter.
Hard stuff to play from a drumming perspective. There's a lot more technical stuff with the feet, you know, and I've always been, you know, more of a single kick, right foot, lead heavy, you know, very heavy on my right foot as a player. So this album's requiring me to really, really work on more footwork, improve my speed, improve my strength, my consistency with both feet, which has been great. It's been a really good challenge and I feel really good about it so far. I've been working on getting that really pretty fast. Way cleaner.
I mean, you're not a blaster,
no,
you know?
No.
But I'm impressed. Blaster, I'm actually really impressed. That blast in the news, like, I was curious how that would sound.
Yeah.
No, it sounds good. I mean, it's,
that felt like it was very easy for you at that
point. That was.
That's yeah.
205.
It doesn't sound like you're struggling. It sounds even. You're getting good. Because I feel like when you used to blast, you wouldn't get a lot of air. You wouldn't get the you know, that center hit on the snare.
I mean, it's.
That's gonna sound great recording.
recorded, because then now you'll be able to hear the snare. You want
it used to kind of be like... This record's definitely, I think, the most challenging rhythmically. I think everybody kind of really dialed it back on Juggernaut for the most part. So coming out of the gate with this one, everybody in the band's just kind of raring to go and be a little bit more technical.
We've revisited a little bit of older material that people have heard demos of from a very, very long time ago. I think it kind of has a mixture of all the sounds that we've accumulated over the years, whether it's the self-titled or Periphery 2 or Juggernaut, Clear. I think it'll really resonate with our core fan base and hopefully bring in new people to listen to the band.
There's a couple old ideas that we're tackling for the album. Chocolate Flobs is an old demo that Misha uploaded to SoundClick in the Bulb days, which we're redoing. And we actually also drudged up Dataless, a song called Dataless, which was a 9-minute epic long song back from the SoundClick days. And we worked that into Chocolate Flobs. We're working Absalom in.
The two of them that are old demos are actually pretty damn old. And I, at this point, honestly thought that they were going to kind of just fade into the ether because they're so old that I didn't really have much interest in, you know, completing them for my solo album or anything like that. And I thought no one else had any interest in them. But Spencer came to the table with two songs, Absalom and this old demo called Chocolate Flobs that he was just feeling really inspired by.
Spencer sent out a vocal demo for Absalom 2 weeks ago, and we were so impressed with it, and we all kind of said to each other, maybe this should be on the album.
I don't know, I felt like a little bit of the old vibe was just lacking a little bit in the new material, and I wanted to bring some of that back. And a lot of the older stuff that never got used really inspired me, especially some of the heavier stuff, like, you know, like you were saying, like the demo of Chocolate Flobs and Absalom just had these vibes, you know, like Chocolate Flobs is super heavy and super groovy, and Absalom was like this, it almost has this like P1 vibe, but at the same time it has like a newer spin on it that we're putting too, so it's really cool. We're like fusing old sound with new sound, and it creates this whole new thing.
There's no singing in the song at all. All rip, straight rip. Beauty disgusting lord! Beauty disgusting blood! Fatal wound of the last emotion! Beauty disgusting blood!
Whew, I got a headache after that. Jesus Christ. Ugh. Yeah, a lot of the screaming stuff on this record is like way more intense than any of the other ones. It's more like they're like full thoughts instead of just being like, oh, what goes well to the song, and it's more of just like, I'm gonna spit my fucking brains out on this. Juggernaut was like pulling teeth compared to this. Like writing a story and making everything fit, and you have to chronologically cram everything in together. It's like, this song has to be here, this has to be here, because it's this vibe, and you're telling this part of the story. So when you're trying to do that and fit everything in its right place, it's like a goddamn puzzle. And with this, it's like, oh, you have this song, you can just do whatever you want with it.
Dug my life about the mug.
Preposition pulling my life above the muck! bad position, pulling my life above the muck! I've never been cool with writing art for the fact of pleasing somebody else. Yeah, with the mindset of pleasing somebody else. You can't do that, otherwise it's not true art. Art is something that comes from your heart and your soul. And I think that's why people are drawn to it, because it's something that's coming from within, and it's not just this thing where it's like you're writing because you want to please somebody else, you want to do something for somebody else. That's not the way art should be, in my opinion.
Can't feel a thing. Can't feel a thing.
Can't feel a thing! Can't feel a thing!
I know this comes off as cold. I know that people have misinterpreted what I'm about to say, but I'm not really thinking about the fans. I'm not thinking about what people want. And I know no one else in the band is. I know that the things that make us happy, and this process of creating, and those moments when this spark of an idea that you have, or this vibe, or whatever, this vision that you have sort of comes together in a way where you're like, wow, that is just what I was expecting. Or even cooler. It's like, I didn't even know it was going to be like this. Those moments, those are the things we care about.
We never ever say, oh, our fans will love this, because I just don't think, I don't believe in that way of writing. Because I think once you start to toe that line of writing for your fans, you know, as much as we love our fans, I think you start to run a risk of becoming disingenuous or contriving your material. What got us here in the first place is writing for ourselves, and I think that's what true art should be.
I'm proud of what we're doing with this record. This is for us. And if people dig it, that's just the icing on the cake.
I'm sure a lot of people will hate it. Hopefully some people will love it. But it's kind of irrelevant.
You getting all that?
Mm-hmm.
Uh-oh.
The solar system has 9 planets.
For your kids. Thanks to Mutual One. Oh, Iron Banner's on?
Yeah, but I'm like fucking...
Anything good?
There's a good sniper rifle.
Really?
Yeah.
Which one?
Oh, you f***. I hope... I f***. Hope that your entire family is in front of you, and then you're and then some guy with pisses on you.
Here's one for Jeff. One for Jeff. Jeff. Black coffee for Jeff. Here. Okay. Next up, what do we got? What do we got? Okay, one black coffee. For,
Misha.
For Mishap. Mishap Asur.
It's too bad our album's called Pan Island, you know?
Periphery last time was personal.
Last time was personal. Rise of the Machines, I think, is not bad. I think it's not bad.
It's fucking ridiculous. Why Rise of the Machines?
Because it's a
Terminator. Other than the Terminator movie.
There's no reason why. What's other... Rogue Nation? It's a Mission Impossible. You know what? Fuck this. Okay, most famous sequels. Here we go. Shrek 2.
Periphery 3, Shrek 2.
Ah, Bill and Ted's Bogus Journey. Periphery
3. Periphery 3's Bogus Journey? Periphery 3's Bogus. That's not bad, actually.
Adam's Family Values. Color of Money. Indiana Jones' The Last Crusade. Oh, Prisoner of Azkaban.
Yeah.
Spider-Man 2. Return of the Jedi. Sued the fuck out of we could get.
No. Yeah. Sued the fuck out of we could get.
I have a thought, guys. I have an observation just from looking at our track listing, because the other day I immensely made a track listing, and here's my thoughts. Like, Loon is the one, like, sort of slow, vibey song on the album, but it doesn't come till the end. It's like the last song on the record, and I was thinking a cool way to break up the sort of, like, intensity of the rest of the album would be to put that thing that you wrote, Misha, that references Loon, you know?
As its own track?
I don't know. That's what I wanted to ask you guys. Like, I
put
think
it at the end of a track. I also like the ending of Cleo, you know, like that acts as like a good little palate cleanser, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Like this whole fucking something, could use this.
What is that?
Sometimes we must make a stand. Sometimes we have to represent what's important.
Is this where the astronauts walk up to the rocket?
You know, I remember a day when they said, no, you can't do this. And I said, well, you know what? I'm gonna try anyways. Because within all of us, there's a kid.
God damn it. That was the saddest thing I've ever seen.
I'm gonna play the saddest music. I'm gonna write a really sad piano tune, and I'm gonna put that over there. I'll show you some. I'll show you some shit. Right here, brother, homie, dog.
I do, dude.
Yeah. That's a proper double bass, dude. Next one to go like that.
So where are we at? We're doing this album a little bit backwards, in the interest of trying something. I guess trying to do this album in a much smaller time frame than we've normally worked on albums without sacrificing the quality. We're at the point now where we're starting to retrack the songs. Spencer is working on the vocals in parallel. There might be slight arrangement changes, but truthfully, he's signed off on the arrangements as they are, so I don't imagine there might be little things here and there when he actually works on it, but I don't think there's gonna be any sort of drastic, like, oh man, this is totally fucked, we need to completely rework this kind of scenarios.
And then we have to hear what Spencer's been up to. We've been getting some demos here and there, so we kind of know how the songs are going to go vocally. But once we know that, and we maybe hear where he like left space in certain parts. We'll have to talk about what guitar solos, if any, are going in, and kind of record those, write those on our own, on our individual own, and then bring them to Nolly. Then we give the arrangement, the finalized arrangements, to Matt, who's going to record drums in the UK with Nolly. We have a majority of the work done at this point, but there's still a bit to go, and we're all really proud and happy with how it's sounding so far.
And Matt is like obsessing over these parts, like a month ahead of him actually tracking his first note, and he's already just like obsessing over all the details and the minutiae. It's pretty cool, and I could tell that he really cares about having this performance represent him. So I think that's kind of awesome. Like, everyone's working really hard.
I don't even know what was so rough about Juggernaut. It was maybe just that I didn't go as in depth as I did with this one.
Oh, I don't know, man. It was like some songs were not rough at all. Like, it was only some of them.
Yeah.
It was like 22 Faces was rough. I think what happened last time is we'd get really solid takes and then we'd go in and like spent a lot of time going over very small parts and being like, no, it's not right, and doing things again.
So I also think we were limited to the schedule.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know. The drum sound for Periphery for so long, and we take it so seriously, and now that we're in this setting, it's just the chance for us to really see what we can get. Second part of that first riff, it doesn't do the triplet thing. It goes, do, do, got. So I do it the first time, but I didn't do it the second part of that phrase.
The space itself, apart from sounding great, just has a great vibe to it. It's kind of just ambient sounding space. You might even be able to hear it on my voice right now. You've got a kind of stone walls plus a high ceiling lined with wood. And the combination of that is just a really lovely, reflective sound that makes the drum sound explosive and lively and really kind of adds this beautiful natural reverb to the space.
There's just one in there.
Yeah, there's
just one. One more time? Yep. The way that I like to play, it's like you learn the part, you get it down, you do it for a reason, but then you go a little bit further and you improvise. So this process has been great for that. A lot of preparation, a lot of rehearsal. But each song on this record has its own sort of set of challenges, for sure. Like, there's complexities in every song. Can't do a split at all, but I can stretch. Oh, there's that calf muscle though. Saying dog. Yes.
It's been an intense process, you know, it's just been Matt and I here in the studio, and that means that I'm the bottleneck really for everything. I'm doing the engineering, the editing, the comping, all of those things, and that means there's so much dead space for Matt where he's not able to record because I'm still kind of taking care of more menial tasks. But it's been worth it, and I think it's nice to be able to cast my eye over every aspect of the drum recording to make sure that it comes out exactly the way that I like.
I find recordings a little bit stressful and a little bit of pressure because not only am I looking at my parts that I record under the microscope and really analyzing every single hit and every single quality of that hit, but so is Nolly. Nolly's gonna hold me accountable for my parts. You know, there's a lot of quality control. So it can be stressful because it exposes the things that you are good at, but also the things that you need to work on.
I've been so tunnel visioned in this process for weeks and months now, and I think we all are. We're honestly a little burnt out from listening and recording and engineering these songs, that we're kind of burnt out because we're just too in the shit, as we say. It's not an extravagant lifestyle. It's pretty simple, everyday lifestyle that we live, but I like it. That's really all I want. If I can live off of music and just live a normal life, have a bathroom and a bed and a PlayStation, I'm happy.
At this point, we've been together for so long that we've learned to work this way. I mean, everybody comes together in the end, you know, and makes it work. And we've been doing it for so long that I think we've just really gotten good at it.
I think the Periphery sound, whatever that is, tends to come rather naturally. So I think if we write together, even the stuff that is kind of out of left field will still sound like Periphery. So I don't think anyone in the band worries too much about trying to sound like Periphery, and definitely wouldn't want to be confined to some narrow path. I think we kind of trust
that will happen, so we don't worry about it. We worry about the other aspects, which is actually writing, creating, and bringing things to life that we're genuinely excited about.
We're not doing it for monetary reasons. If we were in it for the money, then we'd be the hugest idiots in the world, because nobody makes money in metal. I just think it's what we all know how to do. It's like carpentry or any trade in life. It's what we do, and we don't know how to do anything else, really.
It's very, very difficult to become successful producing albums, just albums. So we rely heavily on the touring market to hopefully make a livable wage so we can continue to make more albums. And, you know, we're just doing it while we can. And I don't know if it's ever going to end or when it's going to end, but it's either this or the alternative, which could be very different between all members of this band. Everybody has a different background, different education, you know, and I'm sure everybody has thought about it at some point in their life or their career with Periphery about, well, what would I do if I wasn't doing this? And it's like, the alternative isn't as cool as doing Periphery, so money or not.
Three of the Dream Warriors.
That sounds almost serious.
The Dream Warriors. Three of the Dream Warriors. We fight for your dreams. We're in your dreams.
We fight in your dreams for your dreams.
For your dreams.
And XP.
National Lampoon's Christmas Vacation. Periphery 3 Christmas Vacation.
Restrung the guitar, let's see how it sounds. Perfect. Gent tuning. Just kidding.
Alright. Ready? I can't have a little more bad.
Come on! I
can't work with this guy.
I did slip out of that thing in the end, like, if there was something bothering me.
Slip editing won't save this asshole, look. It's not even ready.
Starts in the middle of the fucking
thing. Says that's not enough, not enough to get it.
He's a hack.
Yeah, fucking hack. More like hack Holcomb, am I right?
Am I right?
Alright.
God damn it.
Right, was that you playing guitar or taking a shit in my ear? I can't tell. Let's do this again.
God damn it. We already know the fucking message is gone, so let's write and throw straight. You can follow with me. Marching fucking against me. Doesn't fucking matter, cause I'm
Jeff, you motherfucker, you got that fucking camera on me?
What?
You got that camera on me?
No, I don't.
Yeah, you do.
It's not recording.
Yeah, this motherfucker over here is filming me raging out on Destiny. About it, I like, look over, I'm like, wait, what? Fuck you, Jeff. You've been really...
Man, I'm so stressed. I don't know what I'm gonna do with my life.
Wait a second. I know.
Who was singing that little dog?
Oh my God.